This podcast was first broadcast on Mendocino County Public Broadcasting on July 18, 2014. It features an interview with Marcelo Gleiser, the Appleton Professor of Natural Philosophy and Professor of Physics and Astronomy at Dartmouth College. He's the author of many books, including The Island of Knowledge, The Limits of Science, and The Search for Meaning. This book addresses such questions as, do all questions have answers? How much can we know about the world? Is there such a thing as an ultimate truth? More information about this series of interviews can be found at the Consider This website. Professor Gleiser, welcome to the program.
My pleasure. Thanks for having me.
So as the subtitle indicates, one of the things you intend to argue in this book is that scientific enterprise has its limits. And I thought I would first ask you a couple of, I think, related questions. What prompted you to write this particular book, and could you begin to orient us to what you aim to accomplish with it?
Yes. So what prompted me to write this book is in 2010, I was invited to a conference at a place called the Perimeter Institute in Canada, which is a theoretical physics place that promotes conferences that sometimes bring together physicists and philosophers. And this was one of them, and the topic was the laws of nature. And I started thinking about what to say to this mixed audience, and I realized that there really isn't a lot of agreement what the laws of nature are. I mean, there are some of them that we all take for granted, like the conservation of energy and conservation of electric charge. But when you start probing into what is a law of nature, you start to find disagreement even within the physicists. And then I realized that you know, it's time to really think about science in a more cultural context, you know, and how it is that it is done in a way that is honest about its construction. And that's where this idea of the island of knowledge, which is the central metaphor of my book, came from. You know, I start to think about it, and I realized that you could picture the development of knowledge as being an island that grows. You know, sometimes it shrinks when you find that an idea we thought was right was actually wrong, and this has happened often in the history of science, but mostly it's growing. We're understanding more and more about the universe and about the world and about who we are. And, of course, this island of knowledge is surrounded by an ocean of the unknown, right? And so you would say, great, the more we know, the more we conquer, so to speak, the unknown, and less questions we have to ask about the world. And in fact, people have written books saying, yep, science is going to reach an end where we're going to know everything. And my construction is precisely the opposite, is to say that that is just not the case. And one of the goals of my book is to make that point real clearly, you know, that the fact that we know more about the world does not bring us closer to some sort of end of the race, but actually allows us to ask questions that we couldn't have anticipated before. So the way it goes is that the island has a shore, right, in between the island and the ocean, and the more we know, the bigger, the longer those shores of ignorance become, meaning we start asking new questions that we couldn't even have asked before. So new knowledge really brings new knowledge with it, but also brings new questions, and hence knowledge is sort of an endless frontier.
You mentioned the way that science is actually practiced. Do you find in the scientific community that some proportion of scientists really are kind of aiming to eventually get the complete story, get the right answer? I mean, I remember, I think it was in the late 90s that a book was published. I don't remember the author off the top of my head, but I think the title of the book was The End of Science, and it was saying essentially, right, well, we've got it all worked out. And then just a year or two later, astronomy found out that we didn't have it all worked out.
Right. So this book is by John Horgan.
Right.
And that's exactly right. He was a Scientific American journalist. He's not there anymore. But yeah, his book was basically said that, you know, the way science is going and we are going to reach an end to the questions that we can ask, and then we just won't be able to do anything else because there won't be any more fundamental questions to ask. And the ones that we could ask, we couldn't build the machines to answer them anyways. So he comes to this grand kind of conclusion, which I think is completely wrong, that science reaches an end. And in fact, he was not the first one. You know, people have done that on and on, including eminent scientists. So in the late 1800s, early 1900s, Lord Kelvin, sort of like one of the fathers of thermodynamics and an incredibly important scientist, made the same sort of declaration. Hey, we know mechanics, we know electricity and magnetism, we know the theory of heat, thermodynamics. We're pretty much done, you know, and so we can just retire and or dedicate our lives to increasing the efficiency of our measurements by, you know, 3 or 4 orders of magnitude. But that's it. No great big ideas will come up. And then, bingo, a few years later, Einstein comes up with the theory of relativity, and then quantum mechanics comes in, and a whole deep revolution in scientific thought took place while Kelvin was still alive. And I just wonder what they thought of that, you know. So I think we learn from this, and we also learn, you know, and I don't want to use history as my as the basis for my argument. I want to use the practice of science itself to try to convince people that it is indeed an open frontier, you know, that there is no end in itself there, because knowledge needs knowledge in the sense that we can only find new things based on what we know now. And as we know now changes because, for example, you have new instruments, you have a new telescope, a new microscope, then we start to learn things that we didn't before and we couldn't have anticipated. So it is always very new, and I think we should be humbled by that and take it on as an ongoing challenge.
There seems to be, in my experience, like with students, there's a strong pull for students to focus on what they know, and we test for that. But one of the things I liked in the prologue, you actually say that it's more about what we don't know that really matters in the practice of science. So I'd like you to speak to that a little bit, but I'm gonna push on to one other part. And I like in the book, and I wanted to talk to you about it because I like the combination of both science and philosophy. There seem to be a lot of people who think they're completely different from one another.
Right.
That science is about the facts and science is about getting to the truth and philosophy is more about, I don't know, extrapolation, speculation. But you really see both of those happening in science as well.
Yeah. So to the first point, you know, what we don't know, basically when we write a grant proposal to the National Science Foundation or Department of Energy, you know, to get some money to fund our grad students, grant proposals are really statements of our ignorance. You know, they say, this is what we know now. They always start like that. But this is where we want to go because there are these questions that we really haven't answered yet. And this proposal is about those questions. So definitely, you know, the way science advances is by asking questions that we don't know the answer to. I mean, that sounds obvious. It's almost like an obvious statement, right? You want to know more, and hence you go ahead and step into the unknown with every tool that you can, you know, your instruments, your intuition, your mathematical apparatus, your computer simulations. And so I would say that every paper in science, you know, ends with the conclusion saying, okay, and now where do we go from here? So basically saying these are the open questions that we still haven't been able to answer with this or that paper. So, yes, and of course, the ability to ask the right questions is absolutely key, right? Because the right questions are the ones that are going to drive new knowledge, essentially, you know. And by right questions, I mean the most fruitful ones, you know, the ones that are going to really lead to perhaps even revolutionary ways in which we can think about the universe and ourselves. You're absolutely right, you know, this schism between physics and science and philosophy, but mostly physics and philosophy really, has been pretty acute. And it's funny because you mentioned that my title here is Appleton Professor of Natural Philosophy, and natural philosophy is the old word for scientist, right? And it was a term that existed until the 1830s, you know, scientists were natural philosophers. And then because the distance between the practice of science, the methodology of science, you know, being very quantitative with the scientific method and the attention to data and to formalizing that data with equations and mathematics, was becoming so clearly different from the questions of value that philosophy was asking, that there was a major split and the term scientist came about. So scientist became different from a philosopher, and a natural philosopher became sort of a dying breed, so to speak, right? And in fact, I am a theoretical physicist by training, but I do think that the kinds of science that I am doing, which are related to very fundamental questions about the universe, what is the Big Bang, how did it happen, how did matter appear, the origin of life, these are fundamental questions that have been asked by philosophy and, by the way, by religion way before science existed. So I know, and it is true in a sense, that a lot of scientists would say, you know, I do my science completely independent of philosophy. And in fact, nothing philosophers have ever said influenced the way I do my science. And I think that is true for the vast majority of physicists operating nowadays. You know, they're technical, they're in their labs, they're doing their things, they're not thinking about the implications of their work for the structure of space and time, or at least from a value perspective or ethics or morality. But in some fields, these boundaries, they just blur. And I find it sort of appalling when physicists that do work on these boundaries, say the origin of the universe, for example, or even the nature of mind, do not take philosophy seriously into context, because they should. And they end up embarrassing themselves. And there are cases in which this has been shown publicly, unfortunately.
A couple of things I wanted to follow up on. First, you said that the most powerful question, asking the right questions is of course key. They're the ones that are the most powerful, the most productive. But you also mentioned that sometimes knowledge kind of goes in fits and starts and sometimes backs up. Sometimes it seems to me that the right question is only seen in retrospect, that it was the right question.
Absolutely. Yeah, we never know for sure what the right question is. But that's the magic of the whole thing, right? I mean, it's, you can call it intuition, you can call it genius, but you're absolutely, there's no like little blue bulb that goes and says, yep, this is the right one, you know, go for it. And a lot of our time is spent taking the wrong directions, right? I mean, I think it was Richard Feynman, this famous American physicist, that said that, you know, we spend most of our time filling up our trash cans with bad ideas, you know. And then once in a while, one actually works, and it's wonderful. But so you have to have tremendous perseverance and resilience, really, to kind of continue in the search. And because a lot of times you go through a big, long calculation or experiment and you don't get anything very interesting at the end, right? So that's sort of the annoying, not so glamorous side of scientific research, right? That it doesn't always lead to great discoveries, that most of the time it doesn't lead to anything very interesting, or when it does, it's also not that interesting, it's just a little result here or there. But once in a while, you know, you it works, right? And you do find something amazing or something unusual. And that's where the excitement lies most of the time.
Well, let's also follow up on this distinction between philosophy and science. And you mentioned natural philosophy. Maybe we can just take a few minutes to give a brief kind of history of philosophy, history of science, and you can talk about some of the pre-Socratics and the questions they were asking and some of the answers they came up with. And some were obviously wrong, but some were kind of right in an intuitive way.
Right. Okay. Okay, starting from the beginning, so you go back to Greece like 600 years BCE, right? So 600 years before Christianity, or 650. And something really amazing happened there, where before, whenever there was a natural phenomenon, it would be explained through mythological or religious thinking. So why does the sun go around the earth? Because the Greek god Helios carries the sun in his golden fire chariot across the sky. And that is a perfectly fine mythic explanation to a natural phenomenon. It's trying to make sense of reality, right? It's trying to make sense of the world as we see it. And myths, lots of myths and lots of religions constructed such narratives precisely to try to order reality, to give some meaning to what's going on, both when there were regular phenomena like, you know, the sun or the day-night cycle or the phases of the moon or the tides, and also when there were irregular sort of mysterious occasions and sometimes very destructive events like volcanic eruptions or tidal waves, solar eclipses that were terrifying to so many and still are to some. And so those mythic explanations were, in a sense, pre-scientific attempts to make sense of the world, right? So when you go to Greece, something really amazing happens, that this group of philosophers that we call the pre-Socratics, because they were mostly lived before Socrates, although the tail end of the pre-Socratics overlaps with him, they were starting to ask questions where their answers were not using mythic explanations, but were picked from nature itself. So, for example, Anaximander was one of these. He was actually sort of the second big philosopher. The first one was Thales, right? So he wanted to know why the sun goes around the earth, right? Because at the point, everything was earth-centric. So he said, well, it's because Earth is surrounded by a bunch of wheels, like chariot wheels, and these wheels have fire within their rims, and sometimes the rims have a hole and fire escapes. And of course, every wheel turns, and hence, as this chariot wheel turns, this fire can be seen as turning around, and that's the sun. Now, you say that's a real silly model of the sky, but it is a major rupture with any sort of mythic explanation, right? It's a mechanical, machine-like explanation of why you have a natural phenomenon, which is the sun moving around. And, of course, now we know that it's not the sun that is moving, it's the earth that is rotating. But the point is that there was a very different way of knowing, right? And that inaugurated this whole intellectual tradition of philosophy. And there was quite a lot of different guys and groups in this pre-Socratic times. And one of them, famously, is the atomists, right? So Democritus and Leucippus, his master, came up with the notion that matter is made of little bits, right? Little bits of stuff. And that those little bits of stuff cannot be broken down into any smaller bits. So there was some sort of fundamental unit of matter. And they said that there were also kinds of atoms, and basically they were indestructible, they were eternal. But as you combine them, sort of like a Lego set, you know, you have the little pieces and you put them together and you make complicated things. That was the idea of the atomists as well, that you could do the same with those little pieces. So this idea of atoms, that matter is made of little bits, stayed with us until modern times, right? I mean, now we know that atoms can be broken down, but, you know, made of protons, neutrons, and electrons, but we're still looking for the fundamental bits of matter, which are called elementary particles, and that is very much the question that drives the modern high-energy physics community. What are the fundamental bits of matter? So you see that there is a huge road that we can trace from the beginnings of philosophy all the way to cutting-edge particle physics, asking the same question: what is the world made of? What is the material composition of the world? And, of course, giving answers that have changed as the methods that we use to understand nature change and the instruments that we use to understand nature changed as well.
One more of these guys that existed a long time ago I think is important to mention because he plays a role throughout your book, and that's Plato. And you can talk about, I think, the two things that I found, two threads in the book, were his allegory of the cave and his kind of idealism about what really exists behind what we seem to think of as reality.
Right. So Plato has this wonderful, famous allegory of the cave in the book 7 of the Republic, right? So he was famous for writing his books in dialogues, like conversations between people. And the Republic is a book where he tries to come up with the scheme that will make the philosopher king, you know, the enlightened ruler of the people that knows what's just and what's fair. And that ruler should know a lot about philosophy. But he starts by composing this allegory that basically is an illustration of how our sensorial perception of the world can be misleading. Like, how can our senses can fool us, essentially. So he says, imagine you have a group of slaves which have been born and chained to since the beginning of their lives, and they can only look forward to this wall in a cave. And all they see, so that their reality, the perception of reality, is whatever is projected onto that wall, such as the same way that we look at a movie screen, so to speak. Now, they do not know that behind them there's this big roaring fire, and there are a bunch of people that carry statues and other objects that they put in front of the fire so that shadows are projected on this wall. So the slaves that can only look forward only see the shadows on the wall. So their conception of reality is based on that artificial construction. They have no idea that there are these people behind them and that there are real objects behind them. So the point that Plato tries to make, he makes many points with this allegory, but one of them is that we are like those slaves. Like most people, we live our lives trying to ground our perception of reality on our senses and some of our prejudices, and that is just not what reality is about. If you want to truly know reality, and that's the connection between the allegory and his other notion, you have to go into the mind, that you can only find truth in the realm of mind, in the realm of thought. And he goes on to describe his categories of ideal categories of thought. So he says that everything has a form, a fundamental form, which is the thought of that form. So, for example, there is the idea of a chair, right? We all have the idea, what is a chair, right? And then you can make that idea real by constructing a chair, and that construction can be incredibly varied, right? You look around, you have all sorts of chairs, but the form, the essence of the chair is a pure thought. And that's what he's saying, that if you want to look at purity and truth, you have to find that. So the same with, like, geometric forms, like the circle, right? So to Plato, the only perfect circle is the one that you imagine with your head, with your mind. As soon as you try to represent that circle, even if you have an amazingly precise printer, it's never going to be perfect. So the perfection only exists in the mind. So he's creating this idea that in order to find truth, you have to look into the world of thought, into the world of mathematical forms, of geometry, and that's really the key to the true nature of reality. Not what we see with the senses that can be misleading, but the nature of thought and mathematics.
So there was, there have been many, but one of the, we can jump ahead in history a bit, a major alteration in the way that people saw reality moved from looking at shadows on the wall to actually seeing something more clearly about reality was the Copernican Revolution. And I'd like you to talk about that a bit. And if you would, draw some parallels to that revolution in thinking to some of the more recent ones that have happened in science that may not have yet kind of reverberated all that far out into general life for people.
Okay, so we're moving here from like the 300 BCE to like the mid-1500s, and Copernicus is publishing his book, and that book had a major change of cosmic perspective, right? Because, and that's very important to my central argument, which is our worldviews change as we discover more about nature, and those worldviews can be profound, and they can be have very tremendous social impact, okay? And that truly has happened. So before Copernicus, everybody thought that the universe was Earth-centered, right? The Earth didn't move. It was the center of everything, and humanity was created by God in its image, and so we were really important, And there was a vertical hierarchy, if you want, where the Earth was at the center, and then you moved through the moon and the planets, etc., all the way to the sphere of the stars. The cosmic was sort of like an onion, you know, with these layers, one inside the other. And then beyond the stars, you had the realm of God. And so you want to ascend in grace to the heavens. So there was a verticalism, if you want, in this pre-Copernican universe that Dante talks about in his Divine Comedy, for example, where you wanted to ascend to the heavens, right? No wonder medieval cathedrals are so tall, right? They force you to look up. And then Copernicus comes in, and he threatens this whole story by saying, hey, you know what? The Earth is not the center. The Earth is just a planet, just like Jupiter and Saturn. It just moves around the sun. The sun is the center. And so with that, his idea caused a major upheaval in this kind of verticalism that people guided their lives. Their whole existence was based on this notion of the Earth in the center. And it was a mess. And Copernicus didn't really answer any of the value questions that came with this change in the centrality of the Earth, right? That they said, you know what, sorry, this is a more beautiful arrangement. He was being very Platonic in his way of thinking. He believed that the sun being the biggest and had to be in the center, the provider of light, and then the planets were arranged depending on how long they took to complete an orbit around the sun. So Mercury, that takes 3 months, was the first. And then Saturn, that takes 29 years, was the last. You know, they didn't know about the other planets yet because they didn't have enough, they didn't have any telescopes in the time of Copernicus. But the point is that there was, for Copernicus, there was a different kind of aesthetic, right? An aesthetic of the time ordering of the orbits of the planets around the sun. And he was, believe it or not, even though his ideas are sold as being revolutionary, he was actually anti-revolutionary. He wanted to go back to Plato, in a sense, and create a universe that was beautiful and mathematically symmetric and ordered, right? And these notions of Platonism, they remain with us today. I mean, a lot of very smart people, they have been trying to find what we call the unified few theory, theory of everything, where all forces of nature are really manifestations of a single force. And that notion, which is very, I think, monotheistic, right, the notion that there is a single force that explains everything, really would be the climax, the apex of this notion that there is a fundamental mathematical symmetry in the universe and everything is derivative of that symmetry, which is very much an idea that came from Plato and most of his disciples, really, but that is part of this thought that beautiful in mathematics means perfection, and perfection means unity, and all of these things mean beauty, right? And in my books, and in this one and my previous one, I try to paint a different kind of image. I try to say, you know what? Yes. Symmetry is a major driving force in what we do, and for very good reasons, because if a problem is very complicated, and if you try to approximate it with symmetry, it makes life much easier, right? I mean, you can solve equations that when you look at the very detailed case, you can't, but if you say, hey, approximate it as a sphere, and everything becomes much easier to deal with mathematically. So symmetry plays an essential role, and sometimes it plays even a discovery role, like we assume a symmetry is true, and because of that symmetry, this or that should happen, like the existence of a fundamental particle, and you go and you find a particle. So it's like almost like nature is listening to us and going, hey, yes, symmetry is a guide to truth. And it has been in many cases, but that does not mean that nature has a rule here, you know, that it has to be beautiful or symmetric. It just means that sometimes it works, sometimes it doesn't work. And when you look in detail at the idea of symmetry, you realize that a lot of what we call symmetric is really just an approximation. That nature is not that symmetric, but we impose this symmetry as an approximation to how we see nature. And that is useful, but that is not final, in the sense that it is really not the symmetry that is fundamental. It's really our approximation to the symmetry that works out for us. And that can lead to a lot of confusion. And so the way I see things now is that if you look carefully about what physics is doing is really about broken symmetries, asymmetries, imperfections as being the driving force behind what nature creates.
Well, let's take another big jump in time and move forward to another revolution that's really the last century. There were at least three that I know of in this field: Einstein, quantum physics, and then ideas about cosmology and what's happening in the universe. And I'd like you to start to get into how that starts to challenge the classical view that math and what we have in our mind and our ideas about reality have a correspondence to reality. That whole idea has really gotten shaken up quite a bit.
Right. So from our perspective as humans, right, you look out and you see the world and you hear things and you feel things and feel with your touch. And so we construct an image of reality based on our senses, right? So you kind of know, yeah, I can see there's a world out there and I move around and I can touch things which are not me, like my pen or my glasses. And so there is this world out there. There is a very objective position that you can take by saying, I am myself and the world out there is something I can see. And in a sense, that is perfectly fine, and that is how a lot of our science has been built, right, with this objective reality out there. And we use our instruments, our telescopes, our microscopes, our detectors, in order to amplify our notion of reality, right? Because we can't see microbes, we cannot see galaxies far away with the naked eye, but our instruments can. So one of the fundamental points of my book is that our nature, our vision of reality is never going to be perfect, is never going to be complete, for one reason being that our instruments are not perfect. Our instruments have limits of precision. They don't capture everything there is to capture. So when you look at stars out there, you're going to see some of them, but you're not going to see all of them because the telescopes cannot catch very faint objects. So they are only looking at a certain kind of light being emitted. And so the point is that every instrument has an inbuilt limit. And so what we gather, the information that we gather from the world, is always going to be incomplete, right? So that's the first limitation to how much we can know about the world. But then, as we move on to the 20th century, these two revolutions you mentioned, you know, relativity and quantum mechanics, showed us that there are other fundamental limits which are not due to our tools, but they are sort of imprinted in nature itself, right? So the first one is the speed of light. So what Einstein showed in 1905 is that light plays a very important role in which it is the fastest speed that can exist in nature. So 186,000 miles per second, which is ridiculously fast. We have no clue what the heck that means. So one way of thinking about that speed is like you blink your eyes and light goes 7.5 times around the Earth. Right. So blink your eyes 7.5 times around the Earth. It is incredibly fast, but it's not infinitely fast, right? So it takes time for light, even though it's so fast, to travel from point A to point B. So, for example, it takes about 8 minutes for light to come from the sun to us, which means that if the sun exploded right now, we'd only know 8 minutes afterwards, right? It would be the last thing you'd ever know because if the sun explodes, that's the end of everything. But the point here is that light takes some time to go from point A to point B, which means if you put this together with the notion of cosmology and that we now know the universe has a finite age, which is about 13.8 billion years. So if the universe appeared 13.8 billion years ago, that light has only had that amount of time to travel, which basically means that we can only receive signals from far away in the universe up to a certain boundary. I call this the bubble of information. And so we all live like fish inside a bowl. We all live inside a bubble of information, which is how far light has traveled since the beginning of time, which basically means that there is a horizon of information. We call this the cosmic horizon. And outside this cosmic horizon, we cannot see. basically, this means that there is a whole lot of universe out there that is invisible and inaccessible to us. So that's another fundamental limit to how much we can know about the world. It's even though we know there is more universe out there, we can't have direct experience of it. It's a little bit like when you are at the beach, you know, and you see the horizon line where the ocean touches the sky. You know that there is more ocean beyond that, but you can't see it. So it's sort of the same idea. We have more universe beyond our cosmic horizon, but we can never see it. We can never be sure of what's going on. So you have not just unknown things about nature. You have unknowable things about nature that come from these discoveries from the 20th century. This first one I mentioned was Einstein's relativity, the speed of light. The other one from the world of the very small quantum mechanics is the science we use to study atoms and fundamental particles. There you have something called the uncertainty principle, which basically tells you that you cannot know precisely, with absolute precision, where a particle is and its speed at the same time. So if the more you want to know where the particle is, the less you're going to know the speed at which the particle is moving, which is almost like contradictory, because if the particle is moving very fast, it can never be at the same place for very long, right? And so that basically tells you that there are limits to how much we can locate small objects in nature and know where they are. And that's the uncertainty principle of Heisenberg, which also imposes some very severe limits on what we can know about the world of the very small, which have amazing consequences to our objectivity and our notion of observer and what's being observed in quantum mechanics.
I want to give my listeners an opportunity, and we'll see how that carries the conversation forward.
Okay.
Caller, you're on the air. May I have your first name, please?
Yes, my name is Anthony.
Anthony, go ahead. Thanks.
Yeah, I was calling because I'm very intrigued by your radio show this morning, and I wanted to get your guest's opinion on string theory and the idea that about bubble universes and what his take on that is and his perspective.
Perfect.
Right. So, yeah, that's a great question. And I do talk a lot about this in the book about string theory and multiverses. But very, very, very briefly, so string theory is basically one attempt to unify the forces of nature, right? So the notion, I think I briefly mentioned that that's sort of one of the kind of the holy grail, right? The idea that of theoretical physics, that we can find that the four forces that we know about today are really manifestations of a single force.
Right.
And string theory tries to do that. No, they're trying to, what is this force and how does that work? Now, it's really not string theory, it's super string theory, and
right.
The super here comes from supersymmetry, right? And that is the assumption that there is an extra symmetry in nature where the particles of matter, like electrons, have shared symmetries with the particles that transmit the forces, like the photon, which is the particle of light, happens to be the one that transmits the electric and magnetic forces. And so supersymmetry transforms one kind of particle into the other kind of particle. And as any good physical theory, it makes predictions. You know, there should be so many particles that are supersymmetric or that show this behavior very clearly. And it turns out that this was proposed in 1974, so in the early 70s, and we have not found a single evidence of supersymmetry up to now. And in fact, the Large Hadron Collider, which is this big machine in Switzerland that found the Higgs boson in 2012, has looked and looked for supersymmetric particles, and nothing has been found.
Mm.
Now, they have a new run coming up with twice as much energy for next year. So we are hoping that, well, some people are hoping that they're going to find supersymmetry, but I remain extremely skeptical. And the point is that if supersymmetry is not found, the whole idea of super strings goes kind of down the drain, right?
Right.
And so my position right now is that the lack of
evidence
support has been compromising the notion of super strings in a very bad way, which doesn't mean that they may not be right. I mean, we can't rule it out. And one of the annoying problems with supersymmetry is you can always say, well, it turns out that this theory only operates at energies way beyond what our accelerators can probe, and we'll never know for sure.
Right, we can't test it. You can't test it, then we don't know.
That is a real problem.
Right.
Say again, sorry?
I was going to say, if you can't test it, if there's no way to determine if it's there or not, then it's great, and a great idea, just like God is a great idea. You know what I mean? So
that's exactly the problem.
Right.
So we are exactly on the same team here. And so it becomes more what we would call metaphysics than physics, in the sense that, you know, it does not fulfill the notion that physical theories have to be empirically validated. That is, they have to be tested. You know, a hypothesis needs to be tested. If you can always kind of hide behind experiments, then we will never know if this is true or not, and then it becomes complicated to justify doing it. The same happens with the multiverse. So the notion of the multiverse is that our universe, with everything that is within this cosmic bubble of information that I mentioned before, is not the whole story. It's only part of a multiverse where many, many other universes could be there, some of them completely different from ours, actually most of them completely different from ours, some of them that live very little, others that live a lot, but they may even have different laws of nature operating in them. So this whole crazy idea, which is beautiful in a sense, and it's not even new. Some pre-Socratic philosophers actually speculated about this, including Epicurus and others. But the point is that the multiverse also has the issue of testability, right? Because
right.
These universes, by construction, are outside our bubble of information. And the only way you could have some inkling of evidence that a multiverse is viable is if a neighboring universe collided with ours in the past, sort of like soap bubbles that collide with one another. And that would create vibrations in the fabric of space in our universe that could, in principle, create some imprinted patterns in the radiation that we see in the sky. Now, this has been calculated and looked for. Nothing has been found, which doesn't mean it's not there. It could be that you need a little more precision, but it is a really long, long, long shot.
Right.
Thanks for the call. I'm going to move on to another caller.
Thank you.
Yep. Hey, caller, you're on the air. May I have your first name, please?
My name is Barry.
Barry, go ahead.
And my question is about, you say something about the arrow of time, and in particular, I'm thinking of a illustration in Feynman's book, QED, showing a electron and positron annihilating each other with, it's a diagram of the world line of this collision. The electron and positron annihilating each other and producing a photon. And the curious notion that positron is not different from the electron, but is that same electron moving backward in time? That's my question, and I will get off the phone.
Thanks very much.
Okay. So, right. So that's just a mathematical trick. It turns out that there is a symmetry in particle physics called CPT, okay, which stands for charge conjugation, which means changing something from positive to negative. Parity, which is basically changing something from a mirror reflection symmetry from left to right. And the T stands for time reversal. So you could picture the positron as an electron moving backwards in time, or you can picture the positron as an electron that has positive charge as opposed to the negative charge electron, and reverse parity. Reverse, so it spins in a different way, in the opposite way. So that is the way that we see it in particle accelerators. So when somebody finds a positron in an experiment, it's not really moving backwards in time. It's just kind of an electron with a positive electric charge. So we have to be careful there. But that's a very good question. I mean, the arrow of time itself, why does time move forward, inexorably as it does, is indeed a very interesting question. And that is a fundamental asymmetry of nature that has apparently to do with what we called we don't know exactly for sure, but that it turns out that the CP that I mentioned, CPT, right, that CPT symmetry is not perfect. So there is an imperfection in this symmetry, and that is related in very deep ways that I don't think I have time to talk about, but I do in my books, where time goes forward. So, again, that's a great example of how imperfections and asymmetries seem to be absolutely fundamental to the structure of how we see nature.
Okay, we've got another caller. Caller, you're on the air. May I have your first name, please?
My name is Phil.
Phil, go ahead.
And I was wondering how, if you have a sense of how the scientific community feels about living with the four fundamental forces and the particles they've discovered, especially the Higgs boson. That's pretty much my question.
How they feel about living. Let's see. So there are two ways in which this discovery was important, right? So the first, the notion of the four forces. So a lot of people are convinced they are the only forces that exist, right? I'm not so sure. I don't think you can actually state with certainty that there are only four forces in nature because, just to connect to stuff I was saying before, our instruments don't probe everything. So it is quite possible that there are other forces out there that we're just not aware of yet. But if you stick with the four forces, we have everything that we know about physics is encapsulated in something called the standard model, right? And the Higgs was sort of the last piece of this jigsaw puzzle. Like, we needed the Higgs in there. And so finding the Higgs was awesome because it sort of convinced us that the standard model based on these four forces does describe everything that we know so far about particles of matter, you know, and how they interact, etc. But on the other hand, it's also a bit of a disappointment because, you see, in physics, in science, you need failure in order to go forward, right? You need your theories to break down so that you have room to create new theories to go beyond current knowledge. So if you, what you're finding with your experiments is basically confirming the theories, you're kind of stuck, right? There's no room for surprise. And that's a little disconcerting because we know there are some questions out there that we haven't answered, and we were hoping that this experiment of the Higgs could provide some clues where to go, and maybe they will still when they double the energy, and we'll find out more next year or so. But so far, it's been such a success story that we're kind of stuck, and we don't really know exactly which way to go. So I would say that the community feels kind of rewarded by finding the particle that we thought existed, which is really amazing, right, that you can use mathematical theory to come up with something that actually exists in the world. But on the other hand, somewhat apprehensive because we haven't found new questions to ask.
Caller, you're on the air. May I have your first name, please?
Yes, Helen.
Helen, go ahead. Thanks.
With all of this wonderful knowledge, I'm wondering what happens to the science philosopher who comes across technology or science that can be harmful to human beings.
Very good question. If the scientist philosopher has a heart and a decent moral structure, then he or she will be appalled by the fact that scientific knowledge can be used for good and for evil. Right. But the blame should not be in the science. It should be really in the alliance between politicians and scientists. Right. So I would say that science has been used for good and bad since the very beginning. Right. So you can use a rock to break the bone of an animal so that you could eat what's inside, or you can use a rock to break the head of your opponent. So it's not a new story. It's a very old story, and I think it has more to do with our moral immaturity as a species, right? I mean, we humans are really capable of wonderful things and horrible things than with the nature of science itself.
Thank you.
Thanks for the call. Okay, so maybe I can ask that question now.
Sure.
We'll see if I get it out. You claim in the book that there is no now, that that is a mental, cognitive construction. And, you know, there's a – I live in Mendocino County, and there's, I think, a fairly strong movement that goes along with the idea of be here now and be in the present. And but you make an argument in the book that there really is no such thing.
Right. So – be here in the now is perfectly fine as a movement. I mean, because we are not using, you know, the now that this movement is referring to is not the scientific now that I am referring to. So that's perfectly fine. But it's true. I mean, if you start to think about this, right? I mean, don't even have to go very deep. You know, the present. When you say now, you're already not in now anymore, right? Because you're already in the past. So you start by saying now, and when by the time you end it, the now is a new now. So time, if you want to think about this, is a sequence of moments of no duration whatsoever, which is sort of like a paradox, right? So the point is that the way we represent space and we represent time in mathematics and in physics is like a continuum, right? We have this continuum, and we break the continuum like a straight line, right, into little points. And you can say, yeah, I have like 1 second, 2 seconds, 3 seconds. But then in between the 1 and the 2 seconds, you have the 1.5 second. And you can always break this interval smaller and smaller. So there is no precise moment in a sense, right? So mathematically, you get stuck with this. And we use the now all the time. But from a critical perspective, it's really not there. It's a mathematical construction. But it's also a cognitive construction in the following sense. Let's say you're playing ping pong, right? And you see the ball and you hear the ball hitting the table, say, and you say, aha, this happened simultaneously, you know, the hearing and the seeing. But the fact that it really did not, because you see much faster than you hear, because the light that traveled from the ball to your eye traveled much faster than the sound of the ball hitting the table to your ear. Just because the speed of light is much, much faster than the speed of sound. Yet, we see those two things as happening at the same time. So from a physics perspective, they don't. And in fact, more than that, whenever you see something that you think it's happening now, it really isn't, because the ball hit the table billions of seconds before you even see it. So again, every information that we have about the world is about light that has to travel from the object to you. And that travel time is small, tiny, if it's something close to you, but it's finite, which means that you're always looking at things in the past. You're never looking at things in the present. So that's why I say there is no now, in the sense that information needs to travel to you. And however, cognitively, you know, you look out into whatever your living room where you are right now, and all these objects, they seem to be there at this very moment in the same place at now, but they really aren't. So it turns out that what happens is that all this information is collected by a visual apparatus, and it is integrated in your brain to give you a notion of presence, a notion of moment, of reality, but that's really a sensorial construction. You know, I mean, it takes time for the nerve impulses to travel to your nerve cells, and yet we have this beautiful idea that, yep, I'm here now. But if you think carefully about it, you're really not. I mean, and at least the world around it, you is not. So that's the sort of notion that we take for granted, that when you start to deconstruct it, you know, you realize that it's much more subtle and honestly, I think, much more beautiful as well.
We're running out of time. Maybe you could tie some of these things, the questions callers asked and everything, into this central idea of what we can know and the limits on what we can know. And if you could kind of summarize that, there's a lot more in your book. It's a fascinating read, so listeners can certainly pick that up. But if you want to just take 30 seconds or so to try to pull things together for this particular interview.
Right. So, you know, whenever I talk about, oh, there's limits to science, people always think it's sort of a defeatist statement. Oh, there you go. You know, so now we can't know everything, and there are questions that have no answers, so why bother, right? And my take is precisely the opposite, is that to think that science can know the truth with capital T is a real heavy burden to carry, and it's completely unnecessary. I think that to admit, to have the humility to admit that there are some questions which are beyond our capability opens up our imagination to find ways of answering things. So obstacles are not sort of like dead walls, but they're triggers for us to create new knowledge. And so to me, to admit that there are always going to be open questions is actually what makes me excited about knowledge, is what makes me want to probe the universe, to understand more about this unknowable, this mystery around everything. And so it's really not defeatist to assume our limitations in understanding things. Is actually an invitation to expand our creativity so we understand the world and ourselves better.
And we're going to have to leave it there. Professor Gleiser, thanks very much for joining us. His book is The Island of Knowledge. You can find links to it on the show's website. Again, thanks very much.
My pleasure. Thanks for having me.
You're welcome.
Bye-bye.